Good morning. Is everyone staying? Turn to page 149. His name is wonderful. In your handbook.
Amazing grace.
Go back a few pages to 326. The first line of this song says, "The Savior is waiting to enter your heart." And when I read that and I see this, I think, have you ever seen the picture of Jesus knocking at the door? That door represents our heart. And the only way he can come in is if we let him in. We ask him in. And this song just spoke to me. I said, I've got to try this one.
Thank you. As I walked through the doors, I sensed his presence, and I knew this was the place where love abounds. For this is the temple, Jehovah God Almighty. We are standing in his presence on holy ground. We are standing on holy ground, and I know presence, there is joy beyond measure, and at his feet, peace of mind can still be found. And if you have a need, I know he has the answer. Just reach out and claim him, child. You are standing on holy ground. We are standing on holy ground. I know that there are angels all around. Let us praise Jesus now. We are standing presence on holy ground. Just let us praise Jesus now. We are standing in his presence. On holy ground. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Well, this morning, have your Bibles with you. John chapter 14. John chapter 14. John chapter 14, And after you have found that, if you would, stand out of reverence of God's word, John chapter 14. I'll just push the rest of it off too as we're going. Everybody? John chapter 14, we'll be starting in verse 28. The word of the Lord says this: "You heard me say to you," Jesus speaking, "I am going away and I will come to you. If you loved me, you would have rejoiced because I am going to the Father. For the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it takes place, so that when it does take place, you may believe." Verse 30 says this: "I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. He has no claim on me. But I do as the Father has commanded me, so that the world may know that I love the Father." And he says, "Rise, let us go from here." Lord Jesus, would you bless your word today? Your word is powerful. This is your word. And so we pray, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, that as your word goes forth, once again, it does not return void. It will do just as you have purposed for it to do. And so, Lord, we thank you for each one of these things. I pray, Lord, would you just continue to help us right now, and Lord, that you would just continue to bless us with this time. And so, Lord, as we do that, I pray, would you help me as I preach your word? I trust you, Lord, for this. Give me the strength that I need based only on who you are. And Lord Jesus, we thank you for everything that will take place. We love you so much. We ask all these things in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. D.L. Moody, who Tony would have shared with you just a little bit ago, D.L. Moody tells of a conversation that he had with a man one time. And the man said this: "My heart is so hard, it seems as if it were chained, and I cannot come." D.L. Moody said, "Come along, chain and all." And he came to Christ, hard heart, chain and all, and Christ snapped the chains and set him free. You see, it truly is the work of God that breaks chains. It's not ours. We have no power in and of ourselves because we cannot break the chains. We don't have the power. We don't have the strength because it's only him and him alone that can do that. So this morning, I want to preach a message that will just be entitled this: What Claim? What Claim? And so, as the Lord helps us today, as we look at this passage of Scripture, Jesus is talking with his disciples. This is the climax of everything that is getting ready to take place in Jesus' life. This is the end where he has drawn his 12 disciples in. This is where he has brought them. This is where he has taken them to the upper room. This is where he has said, "I will break the bread with you." This is where he brings in the one who will betray him. This is where he brings in the ones who will desert him. This is where he brings them in, and he has that last meal with them because he says, "For you truly to grasp who the Father is, what love my Father has, I have to show you this by everything I'm doing now, even knowing what you're getting ready to do." Now think about that. We can tell people we love them all the time, but when's the last time you loved the person that you knew hated your guts? My question to you, when's the last time you told the person that you loved them that hated your guts? By the way, if you ain't loving them, you ain't going to heaven. The second commandment is like the first. Love only the church people as you. What? Oh, wait, that's not right. I must have misquoted that. Love your neighbor. Well, who's my neighbor? Boy, I'd really like to narrow that down. It's that person, guess what, that ain't saved. Gets on your nerves. Hates your guts. That if they had the chance and wouldn't go to jail, they'd nail you to a cross. Let's move on. As Jesus got his disciples alone to be able really to pour into them one last time. Washed their feet, gave them some food to eat on, and then gave them some spiritual food to eat on after he gave them the food to eat on. Jesus begins to share with them the promise of the Holy Spirit that is getting ready to come after he gives his all. And that the Holy Spirit is going to come. That is coming because his Father promised that he would send it. Jesus will be going away, but he promises not to leave them as orphans, right? He promises that. I am so thankful that Jesus keeps his promises that he has made. Here in verse 28, Jesus reiterates what he's already told them earlier in the book of John. If you were to go back, you would see he says, I am going away. If you go back to chapter 14, verse 1 and 2, that's what he tells them. Let not your hearts be troubled. Right? Yeah, I'm going away. I'm heading out. I've got to go back to the Father. This is going to take place. And he reiterates that. And he says, I am going away, but I will come again to you. I will come again. Let not your hearts be troubled. I'm coming back. Do you realize it? Quit looking at the war in Israel. People are having anxiety attacks. They're having to get on medications. They're having to do all this stuff because they're like, well, you just don't realize end times are coming. Well, praise the Lord. This whole world ain't got nothing for us. We just need to say, Lord, now help everybody get saved before you come back. That's what we want to see because he is coming back. He goes on to say, if you loved me, you would have rejoiced because I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. Remember what Jesus did the whole time that he was here on earth? Pointed to the Father, pointed to the Father, pointed to the Father. Why? Because he says, man, I can't do nothing of my own. Jesus said, I can't do it, I can't do it, I can't do it. The Father does it. I can't speak anything, only what everything that I've seen the Father do is what I'm doing. It's all about the Father. And he says, man, if you all would have only grasped what I'm telling you, that I'm getting ready to go back to the Father, man, you all would have been shouting from the mountaintops because he's greater than me. Man, he's stronger than I. He is God of all gods. He is truly the Creator. See, they were trying to wrap their minds around this, and Jesus was truly just saying, trust me. Did you realize he's still saying the same thing today? Your situation, your circumstance, your family, your job, your bank account. It's not everybody else's, it's yours, because he's a personal God. And he says, trust me. Verse 29, he says this, now I have told you before it take place so that you may believe. Jesus begins to prepare them, making sure that this is fresh in their minds, that when this truly does happen, they're not going to scatter, but they'll remember that they have talked about this. Now, listen, did they scatter? Yes, but they came back. Hey, real quick, you say, well, what are you talking about? I'll give you a heads up real quick. Look at what COVID did. Some people have forgotten. They still ain't got back in church. And I ain't talking about this church. I'm talking about all over the world. The church ain't became the church. They ain't gave back to church. They ain't got back together. They ain't got, well, I can just stay at home. Stay at home. But you're losing out on everything that God promised for you that you'd get when you got together. You lost all your strength. You lost all your encouragement. You're losing all your joy. People are losing this. They don't even realize it because Satan has deceived them. Because it should have been, watch this, it should have been like we're doing this morning that we remembered. Guess what? Hey, we may have to stop some things for just a little bit, but we're coming back together. Man, we're coming back and we're going to be excited about this. Jesus was telling them these things to let them know, hey, these things are going to happen, but man, rejoice, because even I'm coming back again. I'm coming back again. Jesus would constantly tell them to remember, to remember, to remember, because Satan's always trying to get us to forget the good things, to remember the bad. I've just, heads up real quick, it is a lot easier to remember the bad than it is the good. It is always easier to remember what that person did to you than what that person did for you. I didn't expect no amens on that, because guess what? Too many times in the church we live that way. We're more worried about what somebody did to me than what they did for me. And we hold that over people's heads until the day they die. And then we walk by the casket and say, Not realizing that hell's getting ready to be our home if we don't switch our attitude. Woo, boy. All right. Oh, me. Sometimes we're so concerned as well about the right now that we can't see the forest for the trees. We've forgotten that Jesus said he is coming back, and all of a sudden something happens and we fall to pieces. And we can't see that there is a bigger picture, that there is a greater purpose, that there are things that's happening that, guess what, are more important than us. Because too many times we get so caught up that if it doesn't benefit me, I'm not really worried about who else it benefits. Because if I'm not the beneficiary, then guess what? Nobody else should be either. So, Lord, you're going to have to help us right now, because right now there's a spirit in here that just ain't of you. And so, Lord, I rebuke that right now in the name of Jesus. I don't know what's going on, but, Lord Jesus, we need your help. So anything that's not of the Lord, we rebuke that right now, and it's gone, it's got to flee, and we thank you, Lord, for that. And so, Lord, I pray that you just continue to help us. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for our church, for our people. But, Lord, we will not stand for Satan trying to do crazy stuff in our midst. We're not going to do that, because you're greater. You're greater, and we thank you, Lord, for that. And so, Lord, you help us right now. Amen. And so now, as we keep going, all of a sudden we see these things, and Jesus is saying, man, I told you all these things. Remember. Remember this for life. Remember this for life. Remember this for life. These type of things have to come into play. Verse 30. Main focus, main part, main thing. He says this, I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. Man. You hear the statement he just made? I'll not talk much more with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. And that throws some people's theology all to pieces. But I want you to realize, if you break that down, he says, man, the prince of this kingdom, King James says, is coming. You know why? Because he is right now. Satan is the prince of this world, the prince of the air. Man, he's messed everything up. And Jesus says that he is coming. This is this. And he says, I will no longer talk much with you anymore. You see, up to this point, Jesus had mentored them. Man, poured out. Up to this point, Jesus has taught them. He poured out. Up to this point, Jesus had walked with them. He poured out. Up to this point, Jesus had explained everything to them. He poured out. Remember, he took these 12, man, and he poured everything out he could to them. And now all of a sudden, he's getting to the last moments of his life, and he said, I ain't going to talk much more with you. I'm about done here. I'm about finished. Everything's wrapping up. Everything's coming to a close. I've already given you everything that I give you. 3.5 years, I poured out, 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 poured out. He said, I've given you everything that I can give you. I've taught you. You've asked questions. I've answered them. I brought you in close. Peter, James, and John, I took you. I've even took you further. I poured into you more, really, than I poured into, because I got you closer in. And I poured into you, and I poured into the things of who he truly is. And now Jesus is saying, my time is about finished with you all, as far as being here in this sense. if you were to go back and read from the time of the Last Supper in chapter 13 until the end of chapter 16. Just think about this. From chapter 13 until the end of chapter 16, he talks them to death. Jesus doesn't quit talking. He just constantly, rattling. Some of y'all are saying like, yeah, we realize it. Like you're doing right now. Those three chapters, Jesus is he's in the last moments of his life. And we have in three chapters, he just rattles it off. And he says, now I ain't going to talk with you much longer. You go back and look at some of those things that he was telling them. Some of those things that he was speaking into their life. And as he gives them this information, as he brings them up there, and as he's sharing with them, and he's truly, right, they're beholding the heart of the Father through the Son. Unbelievably shown. As Jesus knew that his time was running out, he didn't want to waste any part of that. And all of a sudden, he finishes that sentence that we have here in verse 30 with this: for the ruler of this world is coming. For the prince of the kingdom is coming. You see, it was Satan that put it in the heart of Judas to do what he did. Scripture tells us that. Scripture tells us that, watch this, when Judas decided to do it, right, Satan entered his heart. That's what Scripture pulls out. When he decided to do it, Satan entered his heart. And all of a sudden we had this temptation that would come in. It was Satan that blinded the eyes of the religious leaders of the day. He was the one that had them to say, hey, we need to just keep continually go after. And that's what he said, man, you all are blinded in the things that are taking place. It was Satan that would try to destroy all the hope of Jesus and Christianity, because Satan was believing that if he could kill Jesus Christ on the cross, then guess what? Humanity had no more hope. Man. You see, the thing about it is this. Satan thought he knew all the answers. Because the exact thing that got him kicked out of heaven, his pride, ego, arrogance, of thinking that he was better than God. When he came down here, he still thought he could do the same thing. And could kill Jesus and everything would be done. But then all of a sudden at the end of verse 30, Jesus makes a statement that truly should shatter every thought that Satan tries to throw at us. So this morning, sometimes we sit through services and we miss everything that the Lord wants to do in our lives because we get hung up on something either the preacher says or somebody else is doing or what we saw on TV or something we heard on the radio before we got here. And all of a sudden, man, these things, man, start to take precedent over what the Spirit's doing, even in services. Because somebody right now could stand up and walk out and everybody would lose focus. Some of y'all are like, no, it wouldn't happen. That's because you're not standing up here. But if I were to put a mirror up here, and I were to put it from here all the way around, and all it was a mirror, and somebody stood up, you'd see how many people's heads like. You say, oh, you're just over dramatic. No, I just see what's actually going on. And once we lose, watch this. Once we lose focus, Satan says, ah, got it. His tricks have never changed. It's always been the same. Distraction has always been Satan's number one thing. If he can distract, people can miss it. He doesn't care who he uses. And he don't care who misses it, as long as it works. But Jesus makes this statement here in verse 30 at the end. And Jesus says this, that really, just hear this part out. Not me, this Jesus. Hear this part, Jesus says, What he makes this statement here, he says this. Now watch verse 30. I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. The prince of the air, the prince of this kingdom is coming. He's coming into this world. He is the one that's getting ready to be here. He is the one. But watch this. He says this. He has no claim on me. Now think about this. Think about it. He has no claim on me. He has no claim on me. Think about it. He has no claim on me. Jesus is speaking out. He has no claim on me. I know who he is. Jesus said, I know who he is. I know who he is. I know who Satan is. I know what he's doing. I know his schemes. I know everything that's taking place. He has no claim on me. He has no claim on me. You say, Pastor, what are you talking about? Oh, you remember Luke chapter 4. Jesus enters into his ministry. Well, to be able to enter into his ministry, guess what Jesus had to do? He had to go and he had to find John. So he finds John the Baptist. What did Jesus have to do? Jesus had to be baptized by John the Baptist. So he goes to the Jordan. He gets baptized, right? And watch this. All of a sudden, John says this. Hey, God told me the one who I see, the Spirit descend upon us, that is him. That's him. And John says, man, I'm bearing witness to you that when I did that, it came. It's him. It's Jesus. Now watch it. Guess what happened? When that happened, the Spirit. Remember what happened? The Spirit immediately. Now watch it. The Spirit immediately. The Spirit immediately took him out in the desert. And he was out there for 40 minutes. And man, what a hard 40 minutes that was. And Jesus was like, now come on, guys, it's been 40 minutes. Well, 40 minutes is an eternity, right? Well, it is to us. How much longer am I going to have to wait, God? Well, I've been praying. I've been here 5 minutes. God, come on. Jesus is there 40 days, 40 nights. Now, in that 40 days and 40 nights, guess who decides to show up? Luke chapter 4, verses 1 through 13, we find that all of a sudden when Satan does show up, guess what he does? He does not have a picnic with Jesus. He does not say, oh, imagine that, you're here. Oh, he's saying, man, now's the time. Satan says, now's the time, I'm doing it. So he does it. And it says that when Jesus was hungry, Satan said to him, turn these stones to bread. Oh, you could do it. Now watch this. Don't think that the Son of God in flesh, full God, couldn't have done it. Oh, now we sit back and we're like, I just don't know. I'm pretty sure they were walking around in the wilderness in Exodus and manna came from heaven. And it was there. But not only that, he said on the sixth day when he did, I'll make that last. That won't last the other 6 days. I'll make it last on that day so it lasts the seventh day as well. No, he can do whatever he wants to do. So now, all of a sudden, second thing he begins to do, because Jesus would rebuke him with scripture, then it says this. He took him up and he showed him all the kingdoms of the world. All the kingdoms of the world. To you I will give all their authority and their glory. If you'll just bow down to me, remember this. And he says, no. Rebukes him with scripture. The third thing that he does, he takes him to the pinnacle of the temple and says, if you truly are the Son of God, throw yourself off. And then after all that, Jesus rebukes him with scripture. And then if you were to read Luke chapter 4, you will see at the end of Luke chapter 4 that the scripture tells us this. And Satan left until an opportune time. Think about that. Ready? Let's hear that again. It says after Jesus was tempted and he rebuked Satan with scripture, Satan left until an opportune time. Guess where we find out now? Jesus is saying he's coming. You think anything caught Jesus off guard? Absolutely not. He knew what Satan was up to. He knew when he was coming. He actually said it right here. He said, hey, the prince of the world's coming. I ain't got much longer to talk to you. Now what? But he's got no claim on me. You know what he said? We've already been around. I know him. I was in the desert with him. He tempted me 3 times. I already know these things. He's already tried to get me to bow down. He's already tried to get me to throw myself off. He's already tried to get me to turn the stone. He's already tried to get me to that. But I rebuked him. I rebuked him. I quoted scripture and he left. But I knew he was coming back. I knew he was coming back. And he says it right here. And he says the prince of the world. Now he's coming in. But he says he has no claim on me. And all of a sudden we see that the first time as Satan tried to tempt Jesus through desires, through ambitions, through animal-like appetites, through the cravings of human nature, Satan tried to shake Jesus' fixed faith in his Father completely. The first time that he came through. But this second time, watch this, this second time, Satan is coming and he will attack Jesus in a completely different way. It's going to be a completely different avenue, still playing on the master's humanity. You see, Satan does not appeal to the desires of enjoyment. He does not appeal to the ease of life, nor does he appeal to the good that has to offer through Jesus Christ. But what Satan begins to do, he appeals to him by getting him out of pain and suffering. Watch this. Satan comes in and says, hey, all you've got to do is say you don't want to do it and you're scot-free. You won't have to go through anything. Think about this, Jesus. 33 years of your life, you knew what was coming. 33 years you've lived for this. You know what this is coming to. Watch this. He waited for an opportune time. The opportune time is now because guess what? He's getting ready to lay down his life. And Satan said, no, I didn't get him the first time, but I'm coming back now because right now, guess what? He's going to be weak. His flesh is, oh, he's going to be wanting something. Oh, he's going to go to his Father and say, Father, can this cup pass from me? Oh, man. Not my will, but your will be done, that Jesus would continue to say. Satan thought, since he could not get him through the desires of natural necessities, that he may be able to get him because of the future forecast. Think about that. Do you realize what Satan tries to get you with and me with all the time? If he can't get us in the moment, he tries to get us through the future forecast that he tries to put in our minds about what's going to try to play out. And Satan will say, oh, if you do that, guess what's going to happen? If you say that, guess what's going to happen? If you make that decision, guess what's going to happen? If you do this, guess what's going to happen? Watch it. Satan's still coming. He just comes in a different way. And he says, oh, let me tell you what that future forecast is. But let me tell you this. He's a liar. He's a liar. He's trying to deceive you with anything and everything that he can. Satan thought that by talking about the looming storm and the tempest would make Jesus stop. My question to you is this. Has Satan's temptation about what the looming storm may be in your life got you to stop? Because Jesus did say this, hey, listen to me, in this world you will have tribulation. Oh, some of y'all thought y'all was getting out scot-free. No, you still got to go through it, but what? Don't miss what Jesus says at the end. But take heart, I've overcome the world. What? He didn't say you wouldn't have to go through it, he just said he overcame it. Man, we got victory already. So watch this. Do not listen to Satan. Watch this. Do not listen to half-truth that Satan has had since the beginning of time. Watch this. He lied to Eve with half-truth. And he's still trying to do the same thing because what he's trying to do to us, he's trying to do this. He's trying to quote Jesus in our lives saying this. In this world, you're going to have trials. You're going to have tribulations. It right now. Right now, Judy, you're right in the midst of it. Look at this, right in the midst of it, and you're never going to get out. You're never going to get out. You can't even get your head up. You can't even get over it. You can't look over that. Oh, it's too deep. Oh, it's too wide. Oh, it's too high. You can't do it. You can't do it. See, but the thing about it is this. We got to know the scripture about what Jesus went ahead and finished saying. Oh, but take heart. I've overcome all of that stuff. We don't listen to the lies of Satan because it's half-truths. Jesus never lied about anything. He said, yeah, you'll go through it, but don't think that I ain't already conquered it. Don't think I already took care of that. I've already been there. I'm already with this stuff. And he says this and this. He said, hey, listen, he may be coming, but he ain't got no claim on me. Ooh, boy. Man, I love that. He ain't got nothing on me. He ain't got nothing there. You know what that means truly in the Greek, if you were to look that up? When that word there says no in the King James, nothing in the King James, in there, it's absolute. Now watch this. You say, what's that? It literally means this. He has absolutely nothing on me. Think about that. Not even a little piece. Not even a smidgen. Not a smear. Not even a speck. You know why that is? Because the scripture tells me this, that he would be the spotless Lamb of God when he died. That he would be pure, blameless, without sin when he died. And so when he got down here and met Satan, he knew he was coming. He says, oh, boys, don't you worry. Don't you worry. He's got nothing, absolutely nothing on me. Man, I don't know about you. That should get somebody excited. That we serve a Savior that is that sure, that is that confident in his Father, that is so excited about what his Father was doing in him, for him, and through him, that he said, hey, boys, I want to give it to you. And if you read John 17, not just to them, but to everyone who believe on Jesus' name through them, which would mean us. So if you're believing, what does that take us to? What does that take us to? Oh, me. See, Jesus will truly say this, Satan will not get me from the inside. He won't get me from the outside. He says, as a matter of fact, he won't get me whatsoever. He's not going to get me. Now, I want you to know, you can walk out of here saying the same thing. Lord, you're going to have to help us trust your word. We're so ate up. We're so ate up with other people's doctrinal thinking that we can't make it in this world without absolutely just trying to do some awful sin every day. That we just wake up and we're just living in sin. That we breathe, we live in sin. That we do. That is not scriptural. There is nowhere in Scripture that it says that. It tells me that we are victors. It tells me I'm a new creation. What are you? Because if you've been saved, Scripture says that you're a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And so my question is this. If Jesus Christ died for me and he died for you, and he died and he said, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. Now watch this. Jesus had the Holy Spirit when he made this statement. Now you say, well, he was for God. He was for this. Yeah, watch this. Watch this. I've been saved. I've been set free from what I used to be. I'm no longer the same person. I can promise you this. Watch it. I can promise you this. If I was an alcoholic, listen to me. I can't help if you're an alcoholic. Praise the Lord if you're not now. If you're still an alcoholic, you need to get deliverance, right? You need to get victory over alcohol. But the thing is this, I can promise you this. I would never, and you couldn't force me, I'd never go to one single meeting sitting there and stand up and say, hey, my name's Dwayne, I'm an alcoholic if I've been delivered by the hand of Jesus Christ. I'd go to jail before I said something false. Boy, some of y'all wonder why your kids ain't got it. quit telling them to say something that ain't true. If Jesus Christ has changed their life, quit making them live in sin that ain't there anymore. Watch it. If your child used to be a drug addict, but they ain't no more, quit telling them they're a drug addict. They ain't. If Jesus Christ has delivered them from that, let them walk in freedom and try to keep them in bondage. We could say the same thing that Jesus says. Satan has no claim on me. I've been set free by the power of Jesus Christ. He broke the chains. He set me free. I don't have to live in that anymore. I can walk in freedom in the newness of life. And I don't have to say, hey, I'm Dwayne. I'm a drug addict. No, I'm not. I'm free. I'm free. It's about time the church gets free. It's about time the church gets free. Listen to me. Some of you all may be sitting here, and you've been saying this. Watch this. You may have not went to the meetings, but you've been saying the same thing for that many years sitting in the pew. And every day you wake up, Satan's trying to remind you of what you used to be, and you still believe that that's what you are. That is not what you are. If you've got saved, listen to me. I'm not talking about you know about Jesus. Knowing about Jesus don't save you. Atheists know about Jesus. Atheists can quote the Bible backwards and forwards, but they ain't saved. I'm talking about you're saved. You know Jesus done a work in your life. You know he's transformed you. Then the thing is this. It's time to make that claim. Oh, but Pastor, what if I make that claim and I were to slip up? Oh, come on. Now guess what you've done? You've already fell back into Satan's lie. Oh, come on. You're believing some future forecast that Satan knows nothing about. Satan don't know the future. No, sorry. Only my Lord and Savior. So now all of a sudden we look at this, and it's about time we quit believing Satan when he says we can't live the way that Jesus said we could live. Because he says, well, what if you were to this? You know what we need to do? Here's what we need to do. We wake up in the morning, guess what? Here we go. Now, I don't know if y'all, I don't snore, but I'm just doing that just so you know I'm asleep. All right, so then I'll say, and then you wake up. Right, you wake up. Whew, I'm in the world still. You realize when you wake up, you know you're in the world. So when you wake up and you know you're in the world, you know what you do? I'm a child of the King. I'm a new creation. I'm walking in newness of life. I'll never be what I used to be. I'll be what he called me to be. That's the way that I'm going to walk. I promise you, if you do that, you'll have victory. Because you ain't worrying about what you used to be, and you're not worrying about some future forecast that Satan's trying to put in your mind that he knows nothing about. You're going to walk in what he has given you right now, and you said, praise the Lord, he's going to help me today. I have got up, and this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to live for Jesus, because guess what? Satan has no claim on me, and I'm walking that way. And because he has no claim on me, I'm going to live like it. Now watch this. I'm not going around spitting in people's face, telling them I'm better than them, right? Chest bumping them and telling them to get out of the way. That's not how we live it. Jesus didn't live that way. We don't live that way. We, watch this. Scripture tells us, make sure that we are in anticipation of giving people the hope of why we live the way that we live. Watch it. Some people need to hear your testimony about your freedom, that God broke the chains of whatever you were bound in so that they don't have to live that way anymore. Come on, we've got to speak. We've got to give that hope that if he can do it for me, he can do it for you. Woo! And we walk that way. Why? Because he's got no claim on us. Satan has no claim on us. But I can promise you, if the church don't believe it, what makes us think anybody else will ever believe it? David, you can come on up and play. Man, I don't know. But man, when's the last time you really just told Satan, you got nothing on me? No, I mean, really. You say, well, Pastor, I just don't. No. When's the last time you told, you've got nothing on me? Not of anything that I have done, everything that he has done. You've got no claim on me because of Jesus Christ. You have no authority on me because of Jesus Christ, right? You have no power over me because of Jesus Christ. You will not control my mind because of Jesus Christ. You will not control my tongue because of Jesus Christ. You will not control my actions because of Jesus Christ. And that is the way I will constantly live my life. That is the way I will constantly live. That's the constant. Listen. Live in accordance with how he set you free. Because if you'll live like that, you ain't got to worry about stumbling, because you'll be upheld by his righteous right hand. Not my words, scriptures. Jesus, God, Holy Spirit is longing to help us live in this sinful world in a sinless way, so that his name can be glorified. It ain't about us, it's about him. Because everything he's done in our life, we should be telling others, hey, what he did for me, he'll do for you. Let him set you free. Let him set you free. He wants you to live that way. There's a song that we've sung, and man, it's years old. I don't know how old that it is, but it's just entitled Chainbreaker. Some of y'all remember that song? Have you ever found yourself singing a song you don't even know what you're singing? Literally. I found myself doing that. Sometimes I'm like, Lord, just tell me. I don't want to sing a song just to sing it. I want to hear you in it. Chainbreaker says something like this. It says, if you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker. So I just wonder, are you want to be bound in chains claiming Christianity? Or you want to say, he's got no claim on me. He's a chain breaker. He set me free to live in accordance with the word. He's got no claim on his church. He's got no claim on God's people. He is greater than he that is in the world. Oh, may Jesus is coming back. May we be found in the way that he longs to find us. But we got to be willing to live the way that he's asked us to live in this freedom. So would you stand, Lord Jesus?